tarde. Boa tarde e bem-vindos ao Teatro Maria Matos. Estávamos aqui só a aguardar a chegada de algumas pessoas. E, bom, nós estamos aqui hoje para falar de amor e de política. Enfim, um debate que vai ser iniciado pelo Srećko Horvat e que é também o início de um arquipélago dentro do ciclo de Pias, que nós dedicamos à temática dos afetos e que nós achamos importante também pensá-lo e incluir também este tema neste pensamento maior que estamos a desenvolver durante esta temporada a propósito da questão dos pensamentos utópicos e de projetos para os quais esta palavra utopia traz alguma ressonância produtiva, porque realmente acho que não há comunidade também se os afetos não estiverem envolvidos. E hoje em dia nós vemos em várias circunstâncias, e espero que hoje tenhamos, eu não vou agora falar dela, espero que hoje tenhamos aqui a oportunidade também de poder debater e discutir e conversar convosco também sobre algumas delas, nas quais os afetos, sejam os afetos, as aderências a movimentos, os conflitos, nos quais os afetos estão muito presentes na nossa vida política. E é isso que nós começamos hoje a debater aqui hoje, e depois, mais tarde, voltaremos, isto já mais para o final do mês, voltaremos a esse debate com uma conferência com Chantal Mouffe. Para além destas duas conferências, o arquipélago contempla ainda dois espetáculos, uma ópera já no dia 10 e também um projeto dos artistas Ana Borralho e João Galante, no dia que se chama O Gatilho da Felicidade, mas depois podem ver, porque já temos o programa lá fora. E temos também um reader com textos que temos estado a publicar para acompanhar todos os arquipélagos do ciclo Utopia, no qual podem ler um pequeno excerto deste livro, A Radicalidade do Amor. Estou a fazer uma tradução livre do título do livro do nosso convidado de hoje, que é filósofo, vem, como ele gosta de dizer, da Jugoslávia, que foi a Jugoslávia. É alguém que tem esta reflexão sobre a questão do amor na política e que neste momento tem trabalhado muito também sobre a situação atual da União Europeia, através de livros que publicou, só para referenciar dois, What Does Europe Want? E Welcome to the Desert of Post-Socialism. Tem escrito e colaborado com bastante regularidade para os jornais The Guardian, New York Times, El País. Há também um documentário recente onde Srećko refere a situação atual da Europa como uma situação onde se está a exercer ainda uma prática colonial dentro da própria Europa, que está neste momento disponível no canal televisivo Al Jazeera. Isto é só uma muito breve apresentação, para além destas produções a nível de escrita, de livros e nos meios de comunicação. Há também Srećko Horvat fundou também com Yanis Varoufakis o movimento de democracia na Europa, acerca do qual nós podemos também voltar a falar mais tarde. Mas agora vou passar a palavra ao Srećko e vamos, que vai falar então sobre esta questão de como é que uma mudança, enfim, como é que uma mudança pessoal pode também ter, implicar uma mudança ou ter ressonâncias políticas mais amplas. Eu vou passar para aí, depois volto para moderar a conversa. Eu queria só dizer que nós estamos também a fazer, a transmitir esta conferência via streaming, e quem está em casa a assistir pode também colocar questões que eu depois poderei recebê-las na altura do debate e o debate pode ser participado nestes dois níveis. Thank you, Sreko. I just give you a very brief presentation of you and I will give you the stage and I will come back after.
Thanks. Good evening or good day. First of all, thanks a lot for the beautiful presentation. I didn't understand anything except that maybe I'm drinking wine with Yanis Varoufakis or something like that. That's the only thing I understood, Varoufakis, post-socialism and radicality of love. But to be more serious, I'm really glad to be here. It's my first time in this beautiful country and in Lisbon. And, well, the topic of today's lecture, which is called The Utopia of Love, The Return to Radical Politics, with a question mark, might sound obscene, especially during such a sunny day, who would like to listen about someone speaking about love. But also in the time of Trump and reactionary forces and the rise of something which we might describe as new fascism, or some theories call it post-fascism, it might seem, as I said, obscene to talk about love. But my claim is it's not obscene to talk about affects, to talk about emotions, and to talk about love. Why? Precisely because in this era today, what we can see, what we could have seen with the return, with the victory of Trump, but also with the victory of Nigel Farage, Brexit, what we can see now with French elections, with Dutch elections, and with German elections, is exactly the return of passion to politics. We can see that notions which were thought to belong to a past period, to the 19th century, to the 20th century, that these notions and emotions are returning. As a result of the ongoing financial crisis, social crisis, and moral crisis, you can see population, not only in Europe, but you can see it also in the US, which is frustrated, which has strong feelings of anger, and which is unemployed, and which feels insecure, precisely as a result of the austerity measures and the ongoing crisis. So in this situation, what you can see is new leaders, strong leaders coming, such as Trump, promising to make America great again, such as Nigel Farage, who during the campaign for Brexit said that we are going to take our country back. You can see these echoes of Nigel Farage also now in France with Marine Le Pen, who is also convincing the frustrated, unemployed people that Front National will be able to take France back. And what you can see here is that this kind of new politics, which is not necessarily new, it has some resemblance of the politics of the 1930s, is counting on the emotions. And where the left and the liberals and the social democrats are not really strong, is precisely the field of emotions. Because they think that emotions belong to the low culture, popular culture, 50 Shades of Grey, Tinder, Grindr, and so on, and that it's not of no importance to deal with this, what seems as something which is very low. So what I want to do today is to use the occasion of the 100th anniversary of the big October Revolution to invite all of you to go through a journey. It will be a short journey, don't worry, although it might be very long, because it covers so many important and even paradoxical events which occurred during the October Revolution. So I'm inviting you through exploration, through the meaning of love and sexuality through the October Revolution, so that we might be able to return to today's politics and to give some answers how love and emotions and affects could be used for radical progressive politics, precisely to counter and possibly defeat what I call the nationalist international represented by Trump, Farage, Le Pen, and so on. So to start, I'd like to start from a single anecdote, which I think opens a space of interpretation and possible ways of trying to understand the October Revolution. And this is a famous anecdote told by the famous Soviet writer Maxim Gorky, which pictures a very interesting encounter at his apartment in 1920. So it was 1920 at Maxim Gorky's apartment in Moscow that Vladimir Ilyich Lenin arrives. He arrives to the apartment and a famous Russian Jewish pianist is playing Beethoven's Appassionata. According to Maxim Gorky, I will give a quote, there won't be many quotes today, it's not an academic lecture. According to Maxim Gorky, this is what Lenin said. So Lenin is sitting in the apartment and someone there is playing the piano. Quote, "I know nothing that is greater than the Appassionata. I'm ready to listen to it every day. It is amazing, more than human music. I want to say gentle stupidities and stroke the heads of people who living in this dirty hell can create such beauty. But today you must not stroke the head of anyone, they will bite your hand. It is necessary to beat them over the head, beat without mercy, even though in our ideal we are against the use of force against people." And then he concludes, "Duty is hellishly hard." This famous anecdote is usually interpreted as an opposition between the beauty of art represented by Beethoven and Appassionata and the duty of the revolutionary when Lenin says duty is hellishly hard. At the same time, to the critiques of communism, to the critiques of Lenin, it serves to prove the point that already at the beginning of at the early beginning of the October Revolution, so that was 1920, what you can see here, and the anecdote has the purpose to serve the point that, precisely to serve that point, is that what you can see here is that Lenin is already transforming into a cold-blooded dictator who just wanted to beat people without mercy. However, these sorts of interpretations are falling too short, and they miss the really disturbing part of the anecdote. What if Lenin's self-censorship of Beethoven's Appassionata actually reveals something crucial about love? And not only about love, but also about revolution. To really understand the anecdote, why Lenin couldn't listen to Beethoven's Appassionata, well, we have to go back to the early beginning of the October Revolution. At the very beginning of the October Revolution, and unfortunately this is a completely under-researched topic today, which I think academics and especially those belonging to the progressive part of the academia should research better. Usually it's perceived that the October Revolution was only a revolution which broke with the Tsarist Russia, with religion, property rights, and then they imposed the rule of the Communist Party, and then it all ended up in Stalinism and the gulags and so on. But what is not really known, and luckily more and more books and articles appearing who are investigating this field, what is not really known is that at the very beginning of the October Revolution, you had a sort of parallel revolution, which was an integral part of the October Revolution, and this was a sexual revolution. But when I say sexual revolution, it's not only a sexual revolution, it's much more. When I say sexual revolution, I want to say that it's a revolution which took place in the family, which took place in the workplace, which took place in between the relations people have built, which was, in a way, the most radical phase of the October Revolution which we know today. For instance, Friedrich Engels said at that time, before the October Revolution, that there is no real revolution without a sexual revolution, and that it's a curious fact that each time you encounter a big social revolution, you also encounter the concept of something what Engels already called free love. Of course, if you look at the so-called revolutions today, my thesis could be that we cannot speak about real revolutions precisely because these revolutions today, or the social movements, are not speaking about the concept of love and are not transforming human relationships when it comes to the concept of love. At the early time of the October Revolution, that was the 1920s, the famous psychologist Wilhelm Reich visited the Soviet Union, and he wrote the following. He said that from the course of the Russian Revolution, we must learn that economic revolution, expropriation of private ownership of the means of production, and political establishment of the dictatorship of the proletariat automatically go hand in hand with revolution in attitudes towards men's sexual relationship. And Wilhelm Reich was there, he went to kindergartens, he went to the collective apartments which you had in Moscow at that time, and actually he wrote critically about it. But to arrive there, why Wilhelm Reich was critical about it, we have to come back again to the time before Wilhelm Reich visited the October Revolution, before he visited the Soviet Russia. So from the very beginning of the October Revolution, there were two main directions, two main concepts of love and sexuality, and the relationship love and sexuality had to the revolution, and the relationship love and sexuality had to the state and the Communist Party. One main direction, the first direction, was embodied by the concept of so-called free love, which, as you will see, has nothing to do with the, I would even go so far to say, the primitive hippie notion of free love, which didn't mean, you know, people fuck around and so on, and you can have several partners. It meant something much, much more deeper. And it was represented by the young revolutionary, mainly Alexandra Kollontai, but also at that time by young Lenin. The main concept, to cut a long story short, of this direction of the early October Revolution was that the new man and the new woman, in that perspective, can only be created by sexual emancipation and by the radical transformation of the intimate sphere. Then, on the other hand, you had a second direction, which was the conservative reactionary direction, which started to develop at the same time as this first progressive direction. This second direction is known under the name of psychohygiene. Well, you can already see the, you know, something which will appear later during the fascist and Nazi regimes. Each time someone starts to speak about psychohygiene, I think you know that, you know, the totalitarian state is lurking behind the corner. It was represented by a psychoneurologist called Aaron Salkind, who was famous for trying to combine Pavlov, Freud, and Marx. And his main thesis, in opposition to the first direction represented by Alexandra Kollontai, was that the new man, and the woman slowly disappeared from here already, that the new man can only be created by sexual abstinence. That the new man can only be created by sexual repression. So at the beginning of the October Revolution, imagine it like this. You have 1917, you have the October Revolution, you have the Bolsheviks coming into power, and you have two directions, which were, in a way, a result of serious debates and serious discussions. Lenin and Alexandra Kollontai, Lenin and Clara Zetkin and other revolutionaries already had for the decade which was happening before. But when the Bolsheviks came in power in 1917 in October, these two directions start competing with each other, which will become the legitimate and even the legal, the legislative main direction of communist Russia. As you can see here, these two directions of the early October Revolution reflect the same dilemma Lenin had with Appassionata. Do we listen to the beautiful Beethoven, or do we smash the heads of the people? Do we have sex, or do we abstain? Do we have the emancipation of women, or do we have patriarchy again? Do we have the emancipation of homosexuality, or do we have do we prohibit homosexuality again, as Stalin did in 1934? So to return to this main opposition, this fight between free love and repression of sexuality, let us go a bit deeper into these two directions. So the first direction, as already said, was the concept of free love, and it was represented by someone who was previously a Menshevik, but then became a Bolshevik, and in my opinion, it's one of the biggest feminists, not only feminists, but revolutionaries of the 20th century. This is Alexandra Kollontai, who was first and foremost a fiction writer, who wrote novels, but in each of her novels, the topic of love and free love was a central part. Alexandra Kollontai, at the same time, became an activist, and she traveled to Switzerland to study economy. As you know, Switzerland, mainly Zurich, was very important for the Russian dissidents, not only communists, but Bakunin, Kropotkin, and then Lenin as well. Everyone came to Switzerland. So in that atmosphere, Kollontai already started to have discussions about free love. Then she traveled to England, where she got to know the Labour Party. And then she traveled to Germany, where she made friendships which lasted until the end of her life, or at their lives, with Karl Liebknecht and Rosa Luxemburg. When the October Revolution happened in 1917, Alexandra Kollontai became the first female minister in European history. She became the minister of a completely new ministry, which existed before the Scandinavian model, which we know today, and the ministry was called social welfare. So, of course, today we speak about the welfare state as an invention of the social democrats and the historical compromise between capital and labor and the legacy of social democratic Western states such as Norway, Sweden, Finland, Germany to some degree, and so on. But it's not really known that actually the October Revolution and the Bolsheviks invented something which was the welfare state avant la lettre. At the same time, she invents something which is called Genotdel, which means Genotdel. It's those of you who know Slavic languages or Russians can only, Jena means woman, and Del stands for department. It was the woman's department. And the main function of the woman's department, and this was 1917, 100 years ago, was to create better conditions for women which were victims of patriarchy, and to create these conditions in the way that to enforce, but legally enforce, the creation of something what Alexandra Kollontai more theoretically called the nationalization of motherhood, which was then later a bit criticized because I think the term can bring you in wrong directions. But the main point was that the point which feminists today, Judith Butler, Sylvia Federici, and so on, make about the unpaid labor of women in households, for instance. So what Alexandra Kollontai came to the idea, Lenin supported her at the beginning, that in order to have the real emancipation of women, women need to have more time, to put it so simple. They have to have the same rights, but not only the same rights, in order to arrive at the same rights as men, you need to have the same conditions as men, which means that you need to have time. To put it, I'm simplifying, of course, so that she fostered and encouraged the creation of public kitchens, the creation of public kindergartens, which the state, and that was the function of the social welfare state, took over. So the state took over the cooking for the children, the care, and so on. And you can see here that the idea was that a big space of time and opportunity was created for the women. At the same time, that was a more theoretical part of Alexandra Kollontai. The first part was really realpolitik, the Ministry of Welfare. But at the same time, Kollontai, that was already before the October Revolution, started to work on the concept of free love. And as said, free love is cannot be understood. That would be a completely misreading of her term as this kind of simplistic notion of casual sex or something like that. Because already Alexandra Kollontai was aware that even if you have casual encounters, before we arrive to the system of socialism, it will be precisely the man, because of rising inequality, who will use the casual sexual encounters. And don't you have the same situation today? At the same time, she created something which was called the theory of the water glass theory, saying that sexual encounters should be as drinking a glass of water. Later she was criticized for that, but she was again misunderstood. And Lenin was one of the first who completely misunderstood her, by the way. But at the beginning of the October Revolution, all these theories came into power. And they even had a kind of legal form and legal reflection in the system of the early communist Russia. To that degree that already 2 months later, after the October Revolution, in December, Lenin implements 2 laws, which even from today's perspective unfortunately seem radical, because from where I started, what we witness today is precisely the religious, clero-fascist reaction, where in countries such as Croatia or in Poland, they want to prohibit abortion again, where they are, implementing religious education in primary high schools again and so on. So in 1917, in December, only 2 months after the October Revolution, Lenin implements 2 laws. One is the law on the dissolution of marriage, and the other is the law on civil marriage children and civil registration. In other words, these laws might sound technical, the laws permitted divorce, abortion, woman property rights, and homosexuality. In 1934, with Stalin, Stalin outlawed abortion again, and divorce was again impossible, and he prohibited homosexuality. So how is this possible? How is it possible that from 1917, from December 1917, during the 20s, when Alexandra Kollontai was still in power, and where you had this huge wave of emancipation, that you end up in 1934 with Stalin and in the worst reactionary period where women, again, don't have rights, homosexuals don't have rights, and in a way you retreat to Russia, to Tsarist Russia with the same property rights when it comes to women and men. It's possible because at the same time you had the second direction and the second wave represented by Aaron Zalkind. Aaron Zalkin didn't have this kind of interesting life as Alexandra Kollontai will have, so I will not give you this kind of biography, but I will give you just a taste of it, and I think thanks to the theater it's translated here in Portuguese, only one part of it. I will give you a taste of the ideology of this reactionary wave of the October Revolution, which is best represented by 12 commandments, 12 commandments Aaron Zalkin gave. So this is the, when you listen to this, imagine that this is the reactionary force coming in the 20s, leading to Stalinism. First commandment, sexual life should not begin too early. Second, sexual abstinence is essential until marriage. Third, sexual intercourse should only be the culmination of mutual affection. I will skip some of them and come to the most interesting parts. Five, this is very interesting, sexual act should not be repeated too often. Six, sexual partners should not be changed frequently. Seven, which is in clear opposition to Alexandra Kollontai, love should be monogamous. Skip 8 and I come to 9, where you can see the relation between these commandments and the Communist Party and the state. So 9, sexual selection should occur in accordance with class and revolutionary proletarian selection. Revolutionary proletarian selection. Flirtation, courtship should not enter into sexual relations. 11, which Michel Foucault would like, there should not be sexual perversion. And 12, which I really like, I mean, I'm saying this in an ironic way, as you can see, and which at the same time has very deep consequences, as you will see soon. The party has the right to interfere in the sexual life of its members. Sexuality must be subordinated to class interests. So what you can see here in these 12 commandments is what Foucault described. Unfortunately, Foucault didn't deal with this, which is really a pity, but what Foucault described with the period, I mean, from ancient Greece and then with the centuries leading to the 20th century, how slowly sexuality became classified and how slowly the state took over the power of something what Foucault calls biopolitics. But one of the main points, as you can see here, one of the sexual acts should not be repeated too often, not too many partners, monogamy, not too early, and so on. So what you can find out of most of these commandments is a crucial part of the new libidinal economy of the October Revolution, and it is energy saving. So the main complaint against sexuality is that sexuality represents too much expenditure of energy, which prevents individuals to contribute to the society and to build a big communist regime. And here you return to the anecdote from which we started, to Lenin and the Beethoven's Appassionata. Because what Lenin said is, when I listen to the Appassionata, I have the tendency to gently, you know, touch people on their stupid heads. But what we have to do instead of these stupidities is to smash their heads. So we have to invest all our energy into building this new system. And what you can find here, but I will give you a taste of it as well. Usually I don't do this, but the book is not translated in Portuguese, so I'm repeating some parts from the book, but I will give a new twist to it as well in the end. One of the parts which I really liked while researching and working on the book is something what is not really known, but it brings us directly to this theater. It is that before the October Revolution, at the same time before the October Revolution started, theater was very important. But not this kind of theater, but amateur theater. So in all parts of Russia, imagine Tsarist Russia. I mean, there are even anecdotes that 50 years after the October Revolution, some people on the farms in Russia didn't even know that the October Revolution happened because they were so far away from Moscow and from Leningrad. So imagine this kind of Russia. What the communists and the Bolsheviks enforced and fostered was amateur theater. And, you know, previous state buildings, public buildings were used for amateur theaters, where at the beginning, these theaters were used for progressive theater. Like, the people from the village would meet here at the stage, someone would play the Tsar and someone would play the Bolshevik, and then they would discuss about property rights and what to do with marriage and so on. At the same time, as you have all the time during the October Revolution, you had the second reactionary force represented by Aaron Zalkind. So that at that time, what became very popular was agitational dramas, agitational theater, which was used then not for progressive ideas, but was used precisely for something what Aaron Zalkind calls psychohygiene. It was used to educate the uneducated people of from the villages which still believe that they are living in Tsarist Russia, to teach them the new morality and the new sexuality. So in 1927, you have one of my dearest agitational dramas, which is called Sexual Depravity on Trial, which was written by someone called Dr. Demidovich, a physician who warned of the evil effects of masturbation. And it's not a coincidence, the foreword for this agitational drama was written by no one else but Aaron Zalkind. So it's written in a form of a pedagogic, I'm from the Balkans, so sometimes I forget English. It was written in a form of a show trial. So this is also very interesting that actually the agitational dramas, as far as I researched this, but unfortunately there is not enough research done in this field, that I think we could claim that these agitational dramas led to the show trials, which were serious political trials during the Stalinist era. So this agitational drama was written in 1927, before the Stalinist purges, and this is the drama. A bon vivant called Vasiliev abandoned his wife Anna, who was in the third month of pregnancy, and who was forced to make abortion. At the same time, you know, he had syphilis and he slept with other women, so he became a problem for the early communist society. So Anna's brother, called Vatorov, is invited to court as a witness. And of course, he is a party member and the best exemplification embodiment of the young prototype imagined by Aaron Zalkind and the Psycho-Hygien. So here it goes. The defense attorney asks the question, witness Votorov, you are 23 years old. Votorov answers, yes, 23. Are you married? No, I'm not. Well, and how do you approach women? Like a comrade. And how do you part with them? Also like a comrade. You've had children? Me? No. Have you used birth control? Never. So you are not healthy. I'm absolutely healthy. I have never had a sex life. Where you can see it, you know, if you're healthy, it means that you didn't have a sex life. So the defense attorney asks the following question. You didn't have a sex life at 23 years of age. Votorov answers, at 23 years of age. Defense attorney, I have no further questions. So an expert appears and he asks, may I pose several questions to the witness? And the judge says, by all means. So the expert asks the first question. You have experienced attraction to women? Votorov answers, yes. What has held you back from intimacy? Votorov answers, this is a beautiful answer. I'm a member of the party. I need strength for the construction of a new form of life, and I strive consciously so that my sex life does not cripple me or a woman or a child. I'm young and won't need a woman anytime soon. I'm looking for a woman who would be both a woman and a comrade in work. So the experts ask the following question. And so far you haven't found one. Votorov answers, sometimes it has seemed as if I have, but upon checking, it's been clear that it was a mistake. And the expert asks, and how do you check? And Votorov answers, I simply wait. I allow my attraction to strengthen, observe her and myself, asking myself, do I want a child with her? And is that all what restrains you? No, it's not all. I want to begin a sex life when a child will not frighten me. So this is one of the last questions. You have the continuation here. The expert asks, so is this battle difficult? And Votorov answers, here we come back to Portugal, it's easier in the winter, in the summer it's harder. Especially at the beginning of summer. So, as we can see here, this is the ideal Komsomol member. Although he is 23 years old, he is still a virgin, he never had sex, he avoids masturbation, and so on. And you have something which I also really liked, you know, the famous Pavel Korchagin from Ostrovsky's How the Steel Was Tempered novel from 1934. You know what was Pavel's main credo and main motto? Mama, I've sworn myself not to chase girls until we knocked out the bourgeoisie in the whole world. So, and this is the best embodiment of this new sexuality and this new morality of sexuality. But in a way, as you can see here, Mama, I've sworn myself not to chase girls until we knocked out the bourgeoisie in the whole world. It could be uttered also by someone from ISIS. Don't they say the same? I promised myself not to chase girls until we bring the Sharia all over the world. And what you had actually in this direction of the October Revolution, I would say, is a sort of fundamentalism. And it's best described by a dystopian novel, of course, by George Orwell, 1984, who at one point says that the sexual act as such was rebellion and desire was thought crime. And you know that in Orwell's 1984, you have Orwell coined something which was called the Ministry of Love. And he coined something which was also called the Anti-Sex League. So what Orwell actually did is that he criticized and ironized precisely this second reactionary wave of the October Revolution. The best character who explains this in almost Freudian terms, you know Freud's concept of sublimation, is Julia in Orwell. This is the quote. And as you will see, it will bring us back to the main reason why sex and desire and love was so dangerous. My point is because of energy saving. You will see it here in Julia. When you're making love, you're using up energy, and afterwards you feel happy and don't give a damn for anything. They can't bear you to feel like that. They want you to be bursting with energy all the time. All this marching up and down and cheering and waving flags. If you're happy inside yourself, why should you get excited about the Big Brother, 3 years plan, and 2 minutes of hate? And of course, the problem started in Orwell's 1984 when the main character fell in love with Julia, and when Julia opened up desire for him and sexual life. You have something very similar in the first dystopian novel, which was actually the first dystopian novel censored by the Soviet authorities, I think 1923. Zamyatin's We, which is a society where which is a completely transparent society, and it's permitted to put something on your windows only 1 hour a day, but before you do it, you have to register at the state and say with whom you will meet and that you will possibly luckily have sex and so on. So what you can see in these dystopian novels is criticism of the reactionary model of sexuality and this new morality and this new man, not woman, which was tended to be created by Aaron Zalkind. And here we finally come back to the anecdote about the Appassionata. It is the very same tension between jouissance and the commitment to the revolution, between Beethoven and beating people over the head, and it is the same, very same tension between love and revolution. And that the anecdote about Appassionata really has to do with love, and it's not my imagination or something what I'm inscribing inside the anecdote, so it's not really about Beethoven, but about love, it was revealed by someone who was a secretary of the Comintern, who was very close to Lenin and Trotsky, called Angelika Balabanov. Angelika Balabanov, until the 50s, didn't give any public interview, she didn't write memoirs, she didn't speak publicly about this ticklish subject, but in, I think, 1953, I'm not sure, it's somewhere in the book Liliana took, I think 1953, Angelika Balabanov gives an interview, and she explains the anecdote from which we started. So she said that Lenin deeply loved music, and this Nadezhda Krupskaya, the wife of Lenin, could not give him. Ines Arman, you know Ines Arman, that was the beloved, the biggest love of Lenin's life and his mistress, played beautifully his beloved Beethoven. So here we have it. Instead of Beethoven, when you listen to the anecdote, just put in Esarman, and this is the true reason why Lenin couldn't listen to Beethoven's Appassionata. If you still think this is only imagination, if Angelika Balabanov's memoir is not enough, what is interesting is that Maxim Gorky's this encounter of Lenin, Gorky, and Beethoven happens in 1920, which was the year when Ines Arman died. So just imagine now this big revolutionary Lenin coming to Gorky's apartment, coming there, and a Jewish Russian pianist playing Beethoven's Appassionata. He must have been desperate, as any man in love would have been in this moment. So at that moment, Lenin decides to devote his life exclusively to revolution. One of the reasons stated by the abduction, one of the reasons for Lenin's death, they say it was because he worked 14 to 16 hours per day for the revolution, because Ines Arman was already dead. So to cut a long story short, one of the crucial unresolved issues of the October Revolution was actually the relationship between love and revolution. In the end, and it started to develop already the same as, you know, the old story, was it Stalin who ruined the prospects of communism, or did it already start with Lenin? Well, when it comes to the reactionary forces in the field of sexuality and love, it already started, unfortunately, with Lenin. Lenin had serious discussions with Alexandra Kollontai, where he criticized the concept of free love. It was Lenin who said that the new party members, the youth, should focus on swimming and sports, because that's the only way where you can invest your energy, unlike sex. And I think 1920 was the crucial moment when Lenin was a romantic, who turns from the notion of love towards the notion of revolution. But my claim is that precisely this false dilemma between revolution or love brought to the reactionary forces of the late 20s and even brought to Stalinism, which then brought to the laws of 1934, prohibiting sexuality again, abortion and so on, and leading to the purges and even to Gulag. My point is that instead of perceiving love and revolution as oppositions, what we have to do today, and precisely especially today, is to put a conjunction, is to put end in between revolution and love. So instead, love or revolution, we should fight for love and revolution. So to slowly come to the end of the lecture and also open the debate, what I want to do here, which is not part of this and not part of the book, but something new, is to give a new proposition, a new proposal in which way we could think about love and revolution today, and also about utopia. And I think the concept through which we could have seen it also through some of the examples we mentioned, the concept through which we could really radically, progressively think love and revolution and utopia, and it brings us back directly to the stage, is rhythm. Why rhythm? I'm referring back to someone who, by the way, wrote one of the best books about, not love so much, but about falling in love, the French semiologist Roland Barthes. But I'm not referring to this book, but, you know, at the middle of the 70s, Roland Barthes wrote the book The Fragments of the Lover Discourse, where his main field of exploration was the couple and the phantasmas of the couple. You know, is it crying, is it a date, is it sunglasses, and so on. And through this, Barthes succeeds to show, as he already did in his mythologies, that even when we think that we encounter something which usually is perceived the most original encounter which we can have in our lives, Barthes shows, as he did with mythologies, with Eiffel Tower, Citroën, French wine, he shows that also when we fall in love,
we are actually following a kind of schema, a kind of mythologies which are part of something what Barthes calls the lover's discourse. But well, this is another topic, I will not go there. So after the fragments of lover discourse, Barthes becomes interested in something what he calls how to live together. I'm not sure if this is translated into Portuguese. It was translated into English only like 15 years ago or something like that. And it was published in the original transcripts only in the 2000s in French. So after the Lover's Discourse, after Camera Lucida, the book about photography, which is actually a book about his dead mother, Barthes has three lectures at Collège de France. And he does these three lectures annually until a truck hit him in front of Collège de France and he died several weeks later in the hospital. The first lecture was about neutrality. The second one was about how to live together. And the third one was about how to write a novel, because Roland Barthes always wanted to write a novel, which he actually did, in my opinion. And the second is, I think, crucial for imagining a new utopia, for imagining in what way do we construct our relationships, in what way can a revolution be constructed, in what way can something what Arthur Rimbaud calls the reinvention of love be created. And in this lecture, How to Live Together, Barthes claims that the main instance of living together, be it the living together of a couple, being the living together. So when I say how to live together, imagine also this situation now you have in this theater. It's also a form of living together for the last hour and for the next half an hour or something like that. It's also the matter of living together, whether some people here will go for a drink later, whether someone will meet someone, and so on. So the crucial instance of this living together for Barthes is rhythm. And why rhythm? And here Barthes introduces the concept of power. And I think he's the first thinker in political theory, I'm not sure if there are others who explicitly stated this like this, who says that actually power as such, can be interpreted as an imposition of rhythm to everything. So power imposes rhythm, a rhythm of life. Power imposes a rhythm of time. Power imposes a rhythm of thought. Power imposes a rhythm of speech. And if you still don't trust me, just think about the rhythm of mobile phones. How often can you sit calmly drinking a coffee and how often will this mobile phone ring? Just think about the rhythm of Facebook. More than 50% of the American citizens, the first thing they do in the morning is to open Facebook. So this is a completely different rhythm of life, which is imposed by the power known as Silicon Valley and Mark Zuckerberg. Look at the temporality of capitalism, which was investigated by Jacques Le Goff, for instance, in what way the whole temporality was changed already during the, you know that very well in Portugal, during the times of colonialism, when, for instance, the Greenwich Meridian was introduced, and when the world was divided into two parts, when you have the creation of the Western concept of rationality and the Western concept of time, because it was precisely time and the concept of rationality which helped us to colonize Africa, Latin America, and so on. And then we also introduced time there, because time is money, as Benjamin Franklin said. And he was the first one, by the way, to say that. So what you can see is that power imposes temporality constantly. It was the temporality of the 14 hours workday. It was the temporality of the 12 hours workday. It is the temporality of the 8 working hour day. It is the temporality of reintroducing these longer working days again all over Europe. It is the temporality of something what we call precarity as well. So what you can see is Barthes' basic point is that power imposes a rhythm. And in December, on December the 1st, 1976, Barthes, and that's why I really like Barthes, because he doesn't really go into these big political narratives, he shows how politics is inscribed in the everyday life. So in December 1967, he writes, which was repeated later at his lecture at Collège de France, and this is, I think, the best embodiment of how power works and why rhythm is important. From my window, I see a mother pushing an empty stroller, holding her child by the hand. So you can see, imagine the picture. You have an empty stroller, and you have the child, who's like, I don't know, 3 years old. And she walks at her own rhythm, and the child, meanwhile, is being pulled, dragged along. It's forced to keep running like an animal, like one of Dessart's victims. So the mother walks at her own rhythm, unaware of the fact that her son's rhythm is different. And she is the mother. Exclamation mark in Barthes. So what Barthes' conclusion is that in this case, power is affected through this rhythm, not through rhythm, but this rhythm. So the mother has the power, and she imposes the rhythm of the walk of the child, and she is his mother. When we go back to linguistics, there is one, I think, one of the most important texts on the notion of rhythm, written by Emil Benveniste in his Problems in General Linguistics. The text is called The Notion of Rhythm in Linguistic Expression, where Benveniste and then Barthes uses this to construct the theory of rhythm and something what will be important, which is called idiorhythmy. Usually it's perceived that the etymology of rhythm comes from rhythmos, the ancient Greek term, which comes from the Greek word chein, which means to flow. So the usual definition of rhythmos is the regular movement of waves. So imagine the rhythm as waves going like this, like something which has a pattern and which repeats itself. But what Benveniste does is that he shows a completely different history of the word, and he says that the origin of rhythmos can be traced back to ancient Ionian philosophy and to the atomists, to Democritus. And for them, it was a technical term. So prior to the Attic period, rhythmos was never meant rhythm. It was never applied to the regular movements of waves. The actual meaning is rather a form of arrangement. So rhythmos is not this kind of, you know, fluid movement of waves, but it's much closer, but Barthes warns us at the same time very different from the word, from the ancient Greek word schema. So what you have in schema is something fixed, a fixed network. But rhythmos, and that's the reason why we can understand it only through the concept in opposition to schema, is the pattern of a fluid element. It's not the fluid element, it's the pattern of the fluid element, it's the changeable form. And to conclude, finally, why is this important for any possibility of imagining any possibility of utopia or love or revolution? Because it brings us to something what Barthes calls idiorhythmy. And it might sound as a pleonasm, because rhythmos already means the rhythm of yourself, your own rhythm. Idios in Greek means, idios means your own. So idiorhythmy is your own rhythm. And as I said, it might sound as a pleonasm. But what Barthes tries to explore is not the rhythm imposed by power, which is the rhythm of power, the power of the rhythm of temporality, the rhythm of Facebook, the rhythm of mobile phones, the rhythm of the mother who doesn't care about the child, the rhythm of partners in a relationship who don't care about the rhythm about the other, from the other partner, and so on. What Barthes is interested to see, and here he moves away from the couple which he investigated in the fragments of the Lover Discourse, is the rhythm in communities, is the rhythm in living together. So what Bart shows in his, so this is not published as a book, it's only a transcript of lectures, unfortunately, is, for instance, he goes in his imagination to Mount Athos, Mount Athos in Greece, which is a monastery, a collection of priests, of monks, who live together, but live together in the way of idiorhythmy. They live together in the way that each of them has their own solitude, but like for 5 days they are devoted to praying, to reading, to doing stuff in the fields. And each Saturday, for instance, they meet together and eat collectively. So at the same time, they are alone, and they are at the same time together. And this, for Bart, is the ideal concept of idiorhythmy. Of course, not in the way that you could just transpose this to a new political community in the building. But for instance, he mentions also one of the biggest utopian thinkers, Fourier, and his phalansteries, for instance. Because the phalansteries also had a kind of idiorhythmy. And the whole point, if you look at utopias, but also if you look at dystopias, the whole point of utopia is how to create an idiorhythmy. And this was the old Marx notion, you know, that if we have communism, you will be able in the morning to go to fishing, in the afternoon to be a poet, and in the evening to have a dinner with your family or whatever. I'm not quoting Marx now. So I think, to end, what we have to try to understand today is that even in the most intimate sphere, we have to reinvent the intimate sphere, and we have to reinvent the rhythm of the intimate sphere. We have to reinvent the rhythm of the couple in juxtaposition to the rhythm of the power. To give an example, in Catalonia, for instance, what you have in Catalonia is 600 cooperatives, which are functioning. So imagine the situation which is imposed by the Troika and by the so-called, so on the one hand you have the Nationalist International, on the other hand you have the Austerity International, the Capitalist International. What they are imposing is the rhythm of neoliberal capitalism, of austerity measures, and the state who is privatizing economy and the euro in the eurozone. At the same time, look at this as the power and the rhythm which is imposed. At the same time in Catalonia you have cooperatives which are creating their own rhythm. People who live in communes, people who even created an alternative digital currency called ECO, and who are functioning, so they're not living outside of the system, this utopian idea that you could do the Brexit or Frexit or Grexit and so on, and then you would live in a utopia, but they live in the current system and they are creating an alternative system. And I think this is the point of idiorhythmy. And to come back to the very beginning, if we are not able to reinvent love, we will also not be able to reinvent society, and it's impossible to speak about the change of society if we don't speak about love, power, and rhythm, and the most intimate sphere. Thanks a lot, and thanks for being here.
So, thank you, Srećko. Now it's time to open the discussion.
Oh, there is a child.
Yes.
That's nice.
I think that I will start to collect the yep. questions. Perhaps well, on my side there's some lines of thought that I perhaps I would like to I'll not say everything, of course, but now in the end I was almost feeling to ask you to go a little bit deeper in this connection between love and rhythm, and also between the way you mentioned love with the in connection with sex and with expression of intimacy, and then there is a kind of jump to this rhythm aspect. And I was thinking I don't know if you've heard about because I was listening to you and I'm thinking about his. There is a Chilean biologist, Humberto Maturana, who gave a very interesting definition of love. Love that perhaps is connected with what you are now looking for with his Roland Barthes in dialoguing with Roland Barthes. That is, he says that love, it's like this set of behaviors, this domain of behavior that emerges when we recognize the other as a legitimate other. It's not, it can take a lots of different expressions. Mm-hmm. Sex, intimacy, it's one of it. But it's kind of, for him, this set of behaviors that emerge when we recognize the other as a legitimate other, it's like the basis of all social relationship. Mm-hmm. And I was thinking if it makes sense for you, this idea in what you are now
thanks a lot. It's a beautiful question. And I just saw a child and not a pedophile for mentioning it because I mentioned the child. But look, when you encounter children, for instance, you can see people who don't... either they don't have experience or they don't perceive children as human beings, but as kind of animals or someone who is still not educated or experienced enough. What I do when I, for instance, encounter children, I treat children as equals. And only when you start treating children as equals, then the children, then the questions they ask, you can see that these are the most philosophical questions you will encounter today. And it's not by chance, you know, that most of the children's stories, the king is naked, it was uttered by a child. And it's not by coincidence that, for instance, Nietzsche perceives the child as the biggest form of achievement, in a way. I mean, metaphorically speaking. This is about children, and I really like this definition because it can be transposed also to all other human relations, where I think if you really want to create a society which is based on a different foundation, you have to start treating people as equals and as legitimate partners in a discussion or whatever kind of transference, if you want to put it in psychoanalytical terms. When you ask about love and rhythm, it brings us back again to Alexandra Kollontai in a way, because something what Alexandra Kollontai was speaking against was what she called the privatization of heart. So people today in Portugal, you know, with the Chinese coming and so on, speak about the privatization of public assets, privatization of healthcare, privatization of education, privatization of highways, privatization of electricity, like here and so on. But Alexandra Kollontai spoke about the privatization of heart. And it's very interesting because it brings that back directly to the notion of rhythm in love, because what she had in mind is that people who start to be couples, so you fall in love with someone, and usually what people do, which is, I think, a consequence of the romantic idea of love and romanticism, which I think has to be heavily criticized. This is this notion of soulmates and people, you know. You have it already in Plato's Symposium, the old myth that love was created so that you had two soulmates. They were searching for each other, they came together, and once they came together, they became one. I think we should oppose this and to start speaking about the necessity of two, what the French philosopher Alain Badiou, for instance, does. So instead of the love of identity, to start speaking about and also enacting love of difference. And I think it has to do much to do with rhythm, in the sense that when you privatize someone's heart, which is a beautiful expression by Kollontai, what you actually do is you assimilate someone, and you assimilate someone to your own rhythm, and then you become the one. But the one cannot be happy, I think, what Kollontai had in mind, and what also, it's interesting to see that in theology, in real theology, radical theology, you have this tradition, that love actually consists in not closing the space, what you have in the image of the mother pulling the child, imposing your own power, But actually what the mother could have done is, the child is my equal, the child has his or her own rhythm, and we will walk together. And that is the notion of how to live together. And in that sense, also in theology, you have beautiful conceptions of love where they perceive love as opening the space for the other. It doesn't mean as the romantic idea of love, you have it in Hollywood movies and so on, it means I'll find someone and then I take him, and we have to think the same, we have to feel the same, like the same movies, like the same music and so on.
Really, no, it means if someone...
Excuse me?
It's almost against that idea.
Yeah, it's completely against the idea, and it brings it back to Pessoa. In a way, because, you know, love, I think, if it really wants to be radical and if it really wants to be love and not something else, it has something of Fernando Pessoa's creation, which is the heteronyms and the identities. I mean, I feel almost as an idiot speaking about Pessoa in Portugal. There are many more people knowing more about Pessoa than me. But what I find interesting in Pessoa is this constant redefinition. And I think if you have the model of the two, of the difference, in opposition to the model of the sameness and the identity, you have this constant possibility of redefinition of your own identity. So it's not that, you like the same music, so I like this music, oh great, let's have a date and let's have sex and listen to this music. No, it's, you like this music, oh, it's free jazz, I don't really like free jazz, but okay, I will give a chance. I'm now simplifying, but I will go to a free jazz concert. And you know, maybe, as Pessoa did, each time he went into the different identity, he became that person and he added this identity to his own identity. And if we had this kind of heteronomous identities, I think we would live in a better society as well. And we could even go so far to explain this in the terms of social, the rise of Trump and where everyone is sticking to their own identity, assimilating the other.
Thank you. Now, there is someone who wants to a question, a comment. Can you please use the, because we are, yes.
A brief question about Malinowski poems in all this context of Bolshevik revolution.
About whom?
Malinowski. Could you say something? Because when I was young and I read the poems of Malinowski, there was a book translated into Portuguese, which had a very good preface speaking exactly about this changing, this revolution of the way of life and the revolution in the relationship of people that was afterwards subverted in the Soviet Union, transforming, you know, marriage and the couples and everything, all these rituals completely anachronistic or completely returned to a model very, very similar to the model of the West, finally.
Mm-hmm. Well, to be completely honest with you, I didn't read it. I didn't read him so much. But what I know from reading other authors, for instance, Mayakovsky, he had a drama which is called The Bed Bug. And also other, which is also very interesting because he ironizes this Stalinist direction of prohibition of sexuality. And he said that love became a bug and that love became an illness and everyone is becoming ill. So what you can see also with Malinowski, Mayakovsky, is that you have poets, but also dramaturgs and theater directors who are using art to criticize precisely this kind of reaction. And I mean, social realism also became this sort of reaction, which then just was a reflection of the official trend. What was interesting is when you said that you read the preface and about marriage and family, which was similar to capitalism, is that when Wilhelm Reich came to Soviet Russia, and he thought, you know, finally it's happening. Finally you have sexual emancipation. Finally you have everything I was imagining and writing about. And he comes there and he actually is disappointed because he said that, again, you have the creation, recreation of the nucleus family and, you know, everything what comes with the nucleus family, which you have, I mean, it's... You could go so far... I mean, on the one hand, for instance, in the classical Engels, exploration of the origins of private property. He speaks about the notion of family, saying that probably there wouldn't be private property if there wasn't this model of family. And you could fast forward to Thomas Piketty, for instance, and see that even Thomas Piketty does something what Engels did, and he says that the problem of the rising inequality in capitalism today has to do with inheritance. So it has to do with, it's connected to the family. And again, it's connected to love. If you remember what Juliet says to Romeo at the very beginning when they meet, she says something in the sense, I cannot quote Shakespeare, but I'm sorry, you have to get rid of your name. And then she says something like, any flower has a beautiful smell even without a name. And the problem between Juliet, that's the reason why it's a tragedy and why they died in the end, the problem was the names. The problem was the two families. That was the problem because they couldn't be together. So I think what we have to do today, I mean, we are still very far away from that. And that's why I think the October Revolution is interesting, because they went further than we are going today, that we have to investigate what is the family, what is the notion of family today, what are the relationships we are building in the family, what are the relations we are building with other people. And only by that, I think, we can recreate society. In that way, the October Revolution and what I was trying to explore today, I think it's a big, big inspiration. And when I see the new movements today, the new left movements and so on, unfortunately, I don't see that they are really going so deep into this direction. Because they think affects, emotions, love, not important. Thanks for the question. And I'll check out the book and the preface. If
there are two questions. There is one there and then two others.
Can I? You talk about revolution here.
I'm sorry. it's very.
You say we have to fight for love and revolution, and I say not revolution, because it's a construction of another system. Then you talk about rhythm, which I think it's very interesting, when you say time, and I believe that's the only revolution that it's possible to make. And then you talk about rhythms. And
what's the only possible time? Is not the only
yes,
possible?
Okay. For time. And then you talk about rhythms, which has more sense, no? And two things came to my mind. One is that today I read a new in the newspaper saying that the European Union decided that the countries have different rhythms. And so they have to follow these different rhythms. And we are talking about biopolitics, about this assumption of biorhythm, it should be, idiorhythm in a very Machiavellian way. Then I also remembered a musical tendency, which was drum and bass, that disappeared, which was maybe the most democratic and idiorhythm way of being together, alone in your own rhythm, because you had a lot of different rhythms in the drum and bass, and it had an explosion, and it ended. So when you say, I am for love, huh? Don't think that. I'm also for free love in the sense that it's always also an escape from the patriarchic sense of what political impositions, like the one you told, publicized in a way. I think that family is changing, and I don't think it's only in Catalonia, but I think that there's a lot of misunderstandings about how to connect with people. But I don't think that it's a problem of the left. It's a problem of to understand how to say it in an effective way, and it's true that we are losing it. But at the same time, when you see all these researches about how to affect and how to be affected, and that they exist like drum and bass, for instance, and disappear because no longer interest, and then you have politicians assuming that, yes, rhythms are different, so we have to follow different rhythms. How can this affection connect with politics in this way? Mm. And can you still say that revolution has to be defended?
Thanks for the beautiful question. Yes, of course, precisely because of everything you said, I think the revolution has to be reinvented and it's needed more than ever. I'll just focus on two parts which I found very interesting in your question. One is time and the other one is music. But nota bene, I'll forget. It didn't cross my mind, but when I read Juncker, and yesterday, I think all because I traveled, I came from Germany, so I was reading Frankfurter Allgemeine Zeitung and also Guardian. I think five leading newspapers in Europe yesterday had an interview with François Hollande, who is now supporting Juncker's plan, which is precisely a plan about different rhythm in Europe, which is not new. I mean, always there was the idea that we would have A countries and B countries, and in a way we had it. We had the center and the periphery. But what they are trying to do now is to formalize this kind of relationship and this kind of rhythm. So I really like this reading. But what brings us to much more philosophical terms, I would say, is on the one hand time, and on the other hand music. You know what was the first thing what the revolutionaries of the French, when the French Revolution broke out, did? They were going like madmen around the streets and shooting in clock towers. I found that in Walter Benjamin's famous thesis on the history, on the philosophy of history. And it's not by coincidence that all big revolutions, and maybe we will see that also with Trump, it doesn't necessarily need to mean that if you have a revolution, that it's a progressive revolution, that I have to add. But all big social changes reflected themselves in time as well. So for instance, the French Revolution invented a new calendar, Thermidor and all other months, the completely different time framing. The Khmer Rouge, for instance, in Cambodia, which is a completely different example, for me also a very sad example, where communism can end up. And by the way, they experimented with families and then ended up in hell. They had the idea that, which can be a progressive idea, that when you have a child, you just give it away and the whole society is the family. But of course, if brother one, brother two, and the Khmer Pol Pot is your father, then well, the consequences are not really nice for the child. So you have a radical transformation of time with the new social changes and revolutions. And it's a very important topic which we cannot explore more today, unfortunately, because when you look what is the main power of our rhythm today and the main power of our own lives, it's time. It's the capitalist temporality. It is the majority of people in Europe, especially in the periphery of Europe, who are heavily indebted. And what is debt? Debt, as Maurizio Lazzarato shows, but you can trace it back to Nietzsche as well, debt is a promise you make that you will, that's how Nietzsche defines debt. Of course, he goes back to the German etymology of Schuld and Schulden, which means at the same time, if you're indebted, you are guilty, which happened with the Greeks. They were not only indebted, they were guilty because they were indebted. But what Nietzsche says, that the promise as such and the concept of future, I mean, I don't know if he's right or not, but it's a very interesting concept, that the concept of future was created when the first promise was made. And the first promise was made that I will give you this and you will give it to me back in 1 week or 2 months. And what you could call it the metaphysics of temporality, but what you have today, to come back to political economy, is that indebtment and debt enslavement functions exactly through time. What you do when you take a loan from a bank, you actually give your time to the bank.
In what sense? That everything what you do, imagine you take a loan for the next 30 years, everything you do, everything, you know, you have a coffee with a friend, you go to a drum and bass concert, you go to a theater, it is already constrained by the fact, by the promise which you made that you will give the money back. And then, of course, in order to give the money back, you have to work as a slave, and then you cannot give the money back, and then in the end, you have no time at all. So that's... I could speak for hours about time, but I think people have to start noticing in what way capitalism penetrates into our sense of temporality and into our power of our own temporality. I think we lost the power over our own temporality. When it comes to music, I think it's a beautiful description of drum and bass. In the sense that you are alone and you are together, but I would say that don't you have that as well in house music or techno music? In a way, you have the same rhythm. I mean, you're obviously a fan of drum and bass. I did all of this, drum and bass, house, electronic punk, hardcore, and so on. And you could see how in different music styles, you always have this sense of solitude, but community as well. No? Rhythm is, of course, different in drum and bass and in house, but what you have in house music is, in drum and bass is evident that you have to and so on. In house is different. But we don't have to agree, but we will go to a drum and bass party together or to a house party, and then you will see that also people can dance together and be alone. But you are right. Where I agree with you is that drum and bass, house music, techno music was progressive at the beginning. If you look at, for instance, where the first acid house parties were created, or techno, electronic music, it was under Margaret Thatcher's Britain in the 80s. First you had Joy Division, then you had Sex Pistols at the same time in the 70s. And in the 80s, you had factories which were empty because there were no jobs anymore, and you have the young working class, mainly, who went to these parties, which was a kind of protest. And I'm not speaking from theory. I recently had a really insightful discussion with a friend of mine, Bobby Gilseppi from Primal Scream, who played at that time in Jesus and the Mary Chain, and you know he listened to all these bands at that time, and he was Primal Scream was the band in the 90s who were the first band who succeeded to successfully merge together acid house and rock music, and it came from these parties which happened during the 80s. And what Bobby told me is that when they were going to the parties in the 80s, it was a form of resistance to Thatcher. And there weren't so many drugs at that time. And what's interesting also with drugs, what he told me is that at the beginning of the parties, the most famous drug, of course, was ecstasy, which in a way created again this sense of community and being together with other people. I could criticize that as well, because I'm very critical also of the hippie movement that, you know, we are all together and then what? I mean, what happened with the hippie movement? We didn't really stop the war in Vietnam. But Bobby said that you could sense that the parties were transforming and going into a more reactionary direction when cocaine started to come to the parties. Why? So instead of, you know, having people being together and dancing together, having ecstasy, you had 10 guys at the bar standing like this and, you know, feeling very cool, self-confident, because they took a lot of coke, you know. And then at the same time, you had other people doing cocaine, and you know that the sense of community was lost. So what you can see with cocaine is also a drug of capitalism, in a way, ecstasy as well. But to conclude, because we will go into I don't know which kind of drug or whatever, we could also do a category of drugs in what way they are. Whatever, I'll stop here. At the beginning, this kind of movements and music, it were really movements. I remember back in Croatia, the drum and bass music was a movement. House at that time wasn't really, because we had this kind of house music, which was already the reactionary force of house. I'll stop here.
You can keep the discussion after. and
no, then I have to listen to drum and bass. I don't do it so often anymore.
Duas questões ali em cima. Pode ser.
Hi. I wanted to make three points, I guess, or questions just for development, I guess. So the one was about free love. I mean, we notably noticed that you weren't very much fond of the free love notion, la da da. But you missed to explain then what was the deeper notion of free love, and I kind of wanted you to get into that. Also, I wanted to critique a little bit of the way you talked about real theology, which reminds me a little bit of this idea of real science and real ways to look at things. But yeah, I mean, I guess I understood what you meant, but I also feel like the way we look at things is what helps us get to the way we look at things now. So there's no real way of looking at it, just different ways that lead to the way we look at it now. Okay. So, and then I wanted to kind of like you to get into maybe the idea of the gender relationships between people and the way we can do revolution, because I really think that when we look at queer theory and the ways that queer people kind of relate themselves to the world, which is this not normative, really explains a little bit about the way we can make revolutions, and that these revolutions might not be in the majority, but also happen even though there's a norm, or there's a way that people relate within the majority. And I think that queers explain that and see that and do that every day, like choosing families of choice and stuff like that. And I also wanted to think of the way that here in Portugal, we had a republic in 1910, which kind of reminds me a little bit of the revolution you talked about. When we first had the republic that we then that then finished, and then we had a huge time of colonization stuff like that. But when we looked at when we look at the republic, we had really really progressive changes in politics and stuff like that. So it's really interesting how kind of history repeats itself, even though in different places in the world. But yeah, so I wanted to kind of like get into all of these things, which are kind of a lot of things within not only one question. But yeah, so thank you so much.
Thanks. Well, unfortunately, I have to speak about music again, since you mentioned the Republic and Portugal, and it's, of course, Fado. Because what I find interesting in Fado is the following thing that I learned it only recently, that, you know, when you listen to Fado mostly today, it's, you know, about love, longing, and, you know, this classical interpretation of Fado, which is a reactionary interpretation of Fado, I would say. And when you come back to the Republic, what you can see in the 1920s, before the coup d'etat and the fascist regime, is that before that time, Fado was a mean of class struggle. Fado music, as music, was music which, you know, even, I don't know if you can find it today, I found some of the songs on YouTube, you know, they were mentioning Kropotkin, Bakunin, Marx, and even Lenin in the 1920s. And then you have the coup d'etat, which reinforces censorship. So you have the censorship of lyrics of Fado. And then later, after that period, you reach the Fado of today, where, you know, Fado, you know, starts to retreat back to family, to tradition, and this whole emancipatory character of Fado is lost. This brings me back to queer theory, where I agree with you to a certain point, because when you make a research of the period of the 60s, for instance, I'm speaking now about the experience of the communes in Austria and Germany, which were, I think, a prototype of queer politics, and of something what Kollontai, I'm trying to answer all of it, also had in mind with free love. So what they tried to do, and that was also idea of the concept of free love of Kollontai, was that without questioning the notion of private property, we cannot reach a different notion of love, which doesn't mean, as she was interpreted by Lenin, that, you know, you have to treat everyone,
you know, as a potential fuck buddy or whatever, and then in the end, it turns only into not a buddy but a body. But in the sense that in the communes, people were living together, 10 or 15 of them, Kommune 1, the most famous one in Germany, which turned out of the student revolt in Austria as well. But the problem is, and the problem of the revolution of 68, is that this was the same as Fado, very soon appropriated by the system. So you are right that queer are reinventing a new, fighting the old norms, and I would say, but they are at the same time reinventing new norms. But at the same time, they are being reappropriated by the system to the degree that, for instance, Grindr, I wouldn't say that Grindr, for instance, the application, is a revolutionary meme. And at the beginning, it was a meme, before Tinder was created, a meme for homosexuals, mainly. So what you can see here is the same, I think, with Fado. You know, you first have something which is emancipatory, then you have a kind of censorship, then you have the reappropriation, and then you have the new generations today, which don't, it doesn't even cross their mind that Fado sometimes was referring to Kropotkin, Bakunin, Marx, or Lenin. So in that way, I think, in order to really come to the to the emancipatory potential of queer theory, if you want, we have to be self-critical as well. And in order to achieve a reinvention of a kind of revolution, we have to be critical of the revolution as well. And in that sense, I agree with you, yes, you don't have something which is called real revolution or real theology. I did my homework in deconstruction and, you know, the notion of real. I was referring to something which is liberation theology, which is not real theology, but what I wanted to say is that unlike the prevailing discourse and prevailing norms of Christianity, for instance, Christian theology, you already have a subversive theology inside of this theology which existed through all the centuries. And for instance, you have Teresa Forjades, again, Catalunya, who is the biggest critique of the Vatican Church in Spain today, who is, you know, if you ask me, the new Alexandra Kollontai of the 21st century in the field of Catalunya and Spain, against the church prohibition of abortus, for instance, for the same rights inside of the church between women and men. And I think this is the real theology I have in mind. But when I say real, I'm aware of the deconstruction and... Well, what didn't I answer? I don't know. Thanks.
Let's see if I still remember my question. I want you to comment on something that you wrote on your book, which is about the bourgeois way of love. And since you mentioned Grindr and Tinder, I kind of feel that nowadays those dating apps and the way we perceive love and we socially enact love also create a new sense of rhythm, but not one that leads to radical love. It kind of leads to a commodification of love. So could you comment on that? Is commodification of love a threat to radical love? Of course it is, but comment on that.
Yeah, thanks for this question. It could be part of a new lecture about love and technology. Because what people are not aware is that, okay, if you have, let's start from the thesis that if you have a big social upheaval, a big social revolution, it will have effects on the way we treat each other, it will have effects on the family, as I have shown. So if you have a big social, if you have a big big technological upheaval, it will also have reflections on the way we treat each other and in the way we form our relationships. Remember the times when Kafka was writing letters to Milena, when Rilke was writing letters to his beloved, Brecht, Benjamin, or Alexandra Kollontai, Rosa Luxemburg, the beautiful love letters Rosa Luxemburg wrote from prison. How much time it took from one letter to the other, to the recipient, and from the recipient to bring back the letter. I'm not saying this from a technophobia and nostalgic perspective. Of course, you can write letters today as well, but if you can send a message instantly and get an answer instantly, it changes the way you perceive this and the way you enact love as well. So what I'm afraid is that with new technological developments, and I don't think Tinder and Grindr are so dangerous, although they bring, Grindr and Tinder, in my perspective, they can be helpful for someone. I never tried it, for instance, so maybe I'm completely wrong, and I would be happy if someone says that I'm wrong. But in my way, in my understanding, they actually repeat the mantra, the ideology of the free market. So, you go around on your mobile phone or an application, oh, there is someone that someone wants to have sex, I want to have sex, oh, that's not the right someone, let's have someone else. I mean, that's the ideology of the free market, and I think radical love is much more radical than just exchanging partners. But what I'm scared more of is the new technological developments in Silicon Valley, which are taking place now, which is connected to virtual reality, augmented reality, and artificial intelligence. So you probably remember you had these stupid idiots in Portugal as well who were chasing Pokemon around. But what Pokemon did is something which is really dangerous and which in a way will also have reflections in what way we treat other people. What Pokemon did is that for the first time in history of augmented reality, as something what is opposed to virtual reality because it's not somewhere there, it's augmented reality in the sense that you can see it here. I mean, augmented reality is when you drive a car and you have a GPS and the streets arrive here. Or augmented reality is when Tom Cruise in Minority Report walks and you have a hologram advertisement for the next jeans he has to buy. Augmented reality is when a virtual reality is part of your reality. And Pokemon was the first commercial success of the experiment of augmented reality, which then will bring us also to new developments in treating other people, and will also bring us to artificial intelligence and virtual reality, which I think will completely change the way human relationships function and love as well. Because imagine the next time, for instance, I meet you for the first time, we are on a date, and there is augmented reality already, and augmented reality functions in the way that you have Facebook and you have Twitter, and the artificial intelligent machine searches your Twitter, your Facebook profile, and out of this creates everything you like, music, and this music, and we meet, and instead of having really this kind of exploration of the other and meeting the other, everything is already here. And if you think this is a joke, I think last year or 2 years ago at Stanford University, they made a test where they tried to see in what way people who are investigating the likes on Facebook, what can they really actually know about the other person. So they made a test, I don't know the right figures now, and they showed that the colleagues at work need I don't know, 50 likes in order to see what a person likes, then the family, then the spouse. And then they came, I don't know numbers, but the point is that the spouse, the partner, was the closest to really know what would be the likes of the other partner. And the rest, they didn't really know the other person. And then by creation of artificial intelligence, which is now being created, it's of course Chomsky can say, and I agree to some part, to some degree with him, that maybe it won't be created ever because of language and so on, but it would bring us into a generative grammatics, that a machine succeeded to have a better performance than the actual partner by only investigating the likes of the person at Facebook. Because we people, we of course are not machines, we are people. When you go to the imagine you have an ex-boyfriend or girlfriend, and you search at the Facebook profile, and then you see all the likes this ex has done. And what the usual human mind or human emotion does is that you will see this like, oh, he liked that person, and that person is cute, that means she or he likes that person. Or she attended that event, blah, blah, blah. So in a way, we humans, and that's the beauty of humans, are not perfect, so we interpret things. That's the origin of semiotics. What the machine did in this Stanford experiment was that it doesn't stop at the likes. It collects all the likes, and statistically, it can show what is, you know, what is a person in a way. So next time when you meet someone on a date, you will know everything already in front of yourself. And here you come to the other problem. The other problem is not only that you will lose the whole point of falling in love, which is the fall, of course, but this data harvesting is in the hands of 40 white male from Silicon Valley who believe that they can upload their brains and colonize Mars, and who are now, like Peter Thiel, Palantir, creating the register for Muslims, and who are cooperating with the NSA, with Pentagon. And so next time when you Google something, next time when you use WhatsApp or Viber or Facebook, just think about those who know more about you than you know about yourself. And the problem is, not only this, but by the creation of artificial intelligence systems, is that, for instance, if you take the GPS or Google, Google will not probably function, I know I have to end it, we have 8 minutes, but this is important, it will not function in the way that you will put your search inside of the Google. So I'm in Portugal and I will search for the Museum of Discovery, for instance. It's interesting, it's still called Discovery and not colonialism. But Google will know that I'm in Lisbon and then I'm interested in colonialism, and Google will already give me the desire I want to desire. And I think this is the problem also, and it has deep repercussions on love as well. Well, I said I could give a lecture about technology and go on, but...
Well, we are reaching the end point. I don't know. We really need to stop only if there is like a very, very short question with a very, very short answer, that it's otherwise...
I promise to be short.
So, it's okay. Very, very short.
What do you think about the last interventions of your collaborator in one of your books, Slavoj Žižek, who is a person that I admire very much?
What do you think?
What are you feeling about Žižek now? I love it. I like it for him very much. What he writes.
In one sentence,
is difficult. Slavo is my good friend, and in most of things I agree with him, but in some I don't. But I had many collaborators, like the book "What Does Europe Want." Yeah. The preface was written by Alexis Tsipras. So I thought the preface of "What Does Europe Want," which was written together with Slavoj, is written by Alexis Tsipras. So I thought if you would ask me that question, that would be much more complicated. Slavoj, I adore, and I think what Žižek has done to popularizing philosophy and critical theory is something what no one else did in the late 20th century. But not only this. I mean, the philosophy. I think what is the problem with Žižek today? You have the situation that many people love to hate Žižek in the way. Oh, what is he saying about refugees? But what about Trump?
Because they don't understand that Žižek is one of the important thinkers, the most important thinkers of our time. Just connecting Lacanian psychoanalysis with Hegel philosophy. That is very, very important.
I agree with you. So and that one sentence.
That would bring us also to the questions of love, etc.
Okay, also. I agree.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Srećko. And obrigado por terem estado conosco.
Thank you.
E até breve. Espero.